I'm Father Joe Cocucci. I'm here with my dear friend Ann Rice. We're recording for spring of 2008. You know, Ann is the author of a great part of our literary landscape from the late 70s up to the current day. So many of her books had to do with the fiction of the supernatural, and in these recent years she's been writing on the true supernatural with her introduction to us of the Christ the Lord series. And it's good
thank
to be
you.
With you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much for being here.
You're welcome.
It's great.
And you've been taking us on a journey with Jesus as he becomes more and more aware of his identity and his mission.
Right.
You've also been on a journey.
I have. I truly have been on a journey. I think I've been on a journey all my life, really, working my way back to God and finally, in 2002, to a commitment to write only for the Lord. To put whatever skill, whatever gifts, whatever experience I have in his service and to write books about his life. And right now I'm involved, of course, in trying to do all of his life. And I've got two books finished. Road to Cana is the most recent. The first one was Christ the Lord out of Egypt. And I think there might be two more down the road.
Great. In terms of your own journey, have any of the developments that you've gone through personally influenced or shaped the way you're presenting the story of Jesus?
Oh, I think everything you experience as an author really goes into your work or should go into your work. And it's been the nature of my life that I've had wonderful success, which I'm very grateful for, with books over the years. And I've also suffered some staggering losses. And most recently, the loss of my husband in 2002. But I lost my daughter years ago before her sixth birthday. And I've seen many of my loved ones go in the last few years. And I think all of those losses have taught me something and have in some way influenced my writing. You know, you have to dig deep and dig into that pain when you write. And these novels about Jesus are attempts to write really very highly realistic novels about the Jesus of the Creed, the Jesus of Scripture, the Jesus I believe in. And so a lot of the pain of those losses goes into what I write in these books, trying to understand Christ's humanity, trying to understand what he suffered just being among us from babyhood through young adulthood, through adulthood, and then finally, you know, going into his ministry. I try to draw on it all. I try to see it all as a gift, ultimately. And so experience does make an enormous amount of difference.
Mm-hmm. A lot of the theologians would say that really the key to entering into the mystery of Christ is to enter into suffering and loss because, you know, here you have a true God who lets go of the trappings of divinity and takes on flesh and blood.
Right.
And not just any flesh and blood, but poor flesh and blood.
Right.
And then gives up the flesh and blood for our behalf. So it's one
absolutely
giving up after another. So
absolutely, absolutely. You know, when I went into writing these books, what fascinated me more than anything was that the story of the Incarnation involves Jesus coming as a baby and a child. And I thought, you know, I mean, Jesus is God. I believe he's God. I believe he made the world. I believe he came, he died for us, he atoned for our sins. He could have done anything. He could have come and written it all down on stone tablets, you know, the way it was done on Sinai. But he didn't do that. He came and he lived a life of over 30 years with us. And he must have felt terrible loneliness. As my friend Amy Troxler pointed out to me, a religion teacher who was very influential as far as I'm concerned, she said, think how alone he must have been a lot of the time, how alone he must have felt. And that very much colored my work, and I was able to draw on my own experiences of being alone.
And in developing the characters, that really comes through so vibrantly. All of the characters in Christ the Lord, both the first volume, Out of Egypt, and the second, The Road to Cana, mm-hmm. are drawn so well. Now, obviously, you are narrating through the voice of Christ.
Right.
Is there any other character, or are there other characters in the book that you had particular fun developing, or that you really felt you were living through a little bit of?
Well, you know, I try to put myself there. I try to say this is a probable day in the life of the Lord, and as always, some characters just spring to life. They just start talking, and you can't hold them back. In Christ the Lord Out of Egypt, it was Cleopas, the uncle of Jesus, that became the peculiar talker, you know, the wonderful character for me, who would bring up all kinds of points that nobody else really wanted to bring up. And I loved writing that character. I loved writing them all. I really did. If I don't love a character, I usually don't write very much about that character. In Road to Cana, in the recent one, it was a character of Jason, this friend who comes home to Nazareth, who's an educated Jew who's lived in the community in Rome and lived on Rhodes and lived in Alexandria, and he's a bit philosophical, and the Nazarenes in the book sort of make fun of him. They think they make fun of the fact that he writes to his friends in Rome in Latin. And I found him to be a very useful character talking to our Lord about the goings on in Nazareth. It was to me, it worked out very well. And as it turns out, when we get to the end of the book, when we get to the miracle of Cana, well, Jason's there and he plays a certain role.
And it didn't occur to me before when I asked you the question, but, you know, here we have the little girl that left New Orleans who went to San Francisco,
yeah,
and then comes back to New Orleans and sees everything just a little bit differently also, and that might have informed some of the character development.
Yeah. Oh, definitely, yeah. I've lived an unusual life, I think, in growing up in the South and spending 30 years in California, and then coming home to the South, then leaving again. And it has made me conscious of what it means to miss where you want to be, and to travel to places where you're completely shocked by what you see in wonderful ways. I mean, in Christ the Lord Out of Egypt, one of the things I loved describing was Jesus coming from Egypt, coming from Alexandria, coming through the Jordan Rift Valley, and coming to the beautiful green hills of Galilee, and seeing this place that must have been greener than anything he could have ever seen in Egypt. And you know, we went to the Holy Land, you and I, at the end of 2005, early 2006, and we saw that for ourselves, what it's like to drive through that valley, that desert valley, that rocky valley, and then come into that beautiful green land. It was winter when we went, and still it was wondrously green, and I love describing that. I thought that had to have had a terrific effect on the little boy Jesus. It had to.
Indeed. I was thinking about that trip also recently, and you know, we went to a village called Sepphoris, where the Lord probably worked as a young man, as a carpenter.
Right.
And when I read the section in The Road to Cana that describes Hananel's house,
right,
it reminded me of the mosaics and the architecture we saw there. How did the Holy Land visit that we made help to shape specific parts of this volume?
Oh, it helped me an enormous amount. Just to be where Nazareth is today, you know, just to see where the town lies. It looks so different today, it's almost impossible to imagine it the way it was in the times of our Lord. But it was wonderful to see the slopes and to see the roads and to imagine what walking on the roads was like. And also, archaeology is turning up all kinds of things all the time. We know that there were houses like Hananel's house in those areas. We know that people, even in rural Galilee, which we used to think was so primitive, we know now that there were people there who had houses with mosaic floors and mikveh, you know, their own private purification baths and many rooms. And we also know that all through that area there were scribes and priests who went to the temple in rotation. And we know also that the Galileans went all the time to Jerusalem for the high holy days. I think our concept of Galilee has changed a lot in the last few years, and my obligation as a novelist was to try to describe that world in which our Lord might have lived, where you had Sepphoris, where many, many, many carpenters were needed all the time to be constantly expanding the city. I was helped a lot by the trip. I was helped a lot by the trip and the research that's going on.